What's up, everybody? Welcome to the fourth episode of the Get Down. This is Cream. Got my man Gary W.
What's up, guys?
So we wanted to start this podcast around DJs saving money and being prepared for work stoppage, which a lot of us probably weren't prepared for. And it's scary. I mean, it's definitely a scary thing. Gary, I know you said you wanted to start with something that just you experienced.
I mean,
this.
So, you know, I planned at the beginning of the school year when I was teaching to stop teaching in mid-January and move and uproot my entire life to come and move down to Florida on the basis of, okay, I'm going to finally go into full-time DJing after, you know, 13 years of doing both things. And what, a month later, six weeks later, we find ourselves where we're not DJing at all. And, you know, it's really become a scary prospect after about 6 weeks, because it's like, oh my God, now, like, projected wise, like, you know, are we going to get back to work by the summertime? Are we going to get back to work by 2021? Like, you know, when is that next paycheck going to come? And I'm really, really fortunate to have had financial foresight and put a lot of money away over the years of DJing. So it's enabled me to survive even without collecting unemployment up to this point. So, you know, it's not something that all DJs have. I know for a fact I didn't have it when I was 21, 22, 23 years old. You know, I was out there bottle popping in the club, going to see DJ AM and Samantha Ronson every weekend, and, you know, dropping $300, $400, $500 on a night out. And, like, you know, 36-year-old self is kicking, you know, 21-year-old Gary in the head, because, you know, it's just dumb. It was just wasted money, you know, and there's just better ways to go about, you know, financial planning when you are making X amount of dollars a weekend.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard, definitely, because you're getting paid a certain amount of dollars for your DJ sets. And out of that money, you have to take into consideration taxes. You have to take into consideration your benefits. And then there's a percentage of what the check says you made that you actually make. And some of that money you should then be putting into the bank. But it's hard to think that way sometimes, unless you're really regimented. I mean, I came from having a full-time job in sales where, you know, I had a 401k, I had benefits, I had a car, I had an expense account. Like, it was very easy for me to not worry about anything because I would get the money in my bank account and it was pretty much money. I could do whatever I want. So whether that would be save it or spend it or whatever, you know, I had a little built-in buffer. Whereas being a full-time DJ, we don't have that buffer at all. And I don't think in America or in most places, people aren't getting, they're not learning how to save and spend money and really understand, like, what, you know, how to budget your income.
We could have a full episode on the mishaps in the American education system and how they're not preparing people for actual life. Like, you know, I don't need to know about, you know, writers from the 1700s, like, show me how to write a check. You know what I mean?
How many people do you actually think are financially stable that are full-time DJs?
Oh, wow. I mean, you know what? When I wrote an article about this in our on our Medium blog this past week, and I stumbled across a statistic that said something like 70% of Americans are living paycheck to paycheck. That's everybody. That's, you know, now when you take into consideration, you know, a small group of people like DJs, and you go and you rip their, you know, how they're going to make money out from under them for, you know, 8 weeks at the minimum right now, you know, it's a scary prospect.
Yeah. I think it's really hard for people it's hard when you get money to plan to use that money for something else like taxes or like benefits. And I think that's part of the problem and part of the reason why some DJs are in trouble. I mean, I think I'm pretty financially responsible, and I've had my days of wasting money and blowing money on dumb things, whether it's sneakers or clothes or a night out. That, yeah, I wish I had that back, but I think it's important to educate yourself on what can I do with my money to make sure that my future self is going to be in a better situation than I am right now. Because again, we're not contributing automatically to a 401k or some sort of retirement plan. So we need to figure out how we're going to save money and prepare for the future now and in whatever way that we can. And it's overwhelming. And I think that's why a lot of people don't actually do it.
Well, I mean, there's a million contributing factors, right? I mean, we have, you know, just the way, just social norms and like the things that are getting put in your face, you know, on a daily basis. And it's such a materialistic society that we live in. So it's you know, people judging people on what kind of car they drive and what kind of sneakers they have and things like that. And that's what drives this spending before you got it mentality. You know, and we're, listen, we've all been there. And, you know, I've done it a million times, planning vacations before I had the money to do so, or, you know, waiting on my tax return and being like expending my tax return before I have it. Like, that's a big one, you know, because you get this nice chunk of change and, you know, oh, I'm going to go on vacation with it. So we're all guilty of it. It's just getting ahead of that, being like, okay, I'm going to get three grand my tax return, you know, take 1,000 of that and put it on the side, you know, or take half of it and put it on the side. You know, it's being responsible enough to do those kind of things. And that's what you need to really be aware of and be conscious of, you know, when you're acquiring money and, you know, especially in our, like I said, in our world, you don't know when the next gig is coming. You know, you can be working 5 gigs this weekend and have 1 gig next week. And that's a very real scenario for a lot of DJs.
I can only imagine how some people are feeling right now, because I save money and I have a fallback in case of situations like this. I obviously didn't think this would be the reason why I was digging into my savings, but you know, we're lucky enough because all the money that we've made from our Get Down business, we've saved or invested back into the company. So we have that as a fallback, and then we have our own personal savings. But you know, for people that weren't prepared for this, like how many months can they live like this? You know, like unemployment is not enough to get you through, especially where we live, where rents are crazy expensive and cost of living is expensive.
You know what? And that brings me to my next point. If I didn't move out of Montclair, New Jersey and down to Florida, and I was only living on my teacher salary, which would have been where I was at, I couldn't have afforded to live in my house. Like, that's ridiculous. I can actually afford more to live here. Well, because, you know, my girlfriend gives me rent money here, but like, you know, I can, it's almost more affordable, you know, and live on my savings here than it would have been to, you know, I would have been spending a lot, digging into my savings a lot more in Montclair, you know, but like you're saying, where, you know, that the metropolitan city areas, there's no way that with the rent prices and the taxes, if you're a homeowner, that if you're a full-time DJ, that you can even, you know, remotely think about surviving right now without a government check.
Yeah, it's scary. And I've been, you know, I worry and I've been scared and I've been anxious about the whole situation. I mean, unemployment helps a little bit, but doesn't nearly cover expenses. So, you know, we understand definitely. And I think this is a lesson for everybody, that understanding your financial situation and understand how much money you're making on a monthly basis and how much money you need to live on a monthly basis is super important. Like, budget out. I read a book a couple of years ago. It was called I Will Teach You to Be Rich by Ramit Sethi. And it was one of the best things that I read. A lot of it taught me stuff that I already knew, but it was just really good to hear it and read about it in one space. But it helps you it helps you do just that. And that's get a hold of your financial situation and understand where you're at. And I think a lot of people don't know that because they're scared to dig into it.
So, you know, we work in a industry that has a lot of ego. If you don't have a lot of ego in our industry, you're not going to make it. That's number one, right? Like you need to have a little bit of ego to withstand the storms out here. So in times like these, though, you got to kind of check your ego at the door and you got to put your tail between your legs. And if you need to get a job in order to preserve the longevity of your nightlife career so you can actually live still and pay the rent and put food on the table, you know, you have to do that. There, one of the things I talk about in the article is making sacrifices to, you know, to achieve your financial goals, right? So if that sacrifice is unfortunately, you know, getting a part-time job, and that's going to dig a little bit into your maybe music production, you know, or things like that, or, you know, you're going to have to sacrifice sleep where you're kind of set back to the beginning where you're, you know, either going to class and you're in college and then having to, you know, work and DJ all night and then network and then wake up the next morning and go to class and do it all over again. I mean, if you have to go back to doing that, you have to go back to doing that. You know, it's unfortunate, but we all do need to check our egos once in a while and do what's right for us, even if it's just a short period of time.
Yeah, I don't think anybody should feel bad if they go get any kind of job, especially right now. I mean, if somebody knocks your hustle, then I don't know. That's not really somebody that I want to associate myself with. Because for me, I don't know. Growing up, like,
it's just that
I was always trying to make money. And when I was growing up, I used to always get told, like, we can't afford this, we can't do this, or I can't buy you this. So as soon as I could go make money, I was like, I want to make money because I don't want to ever have to say I can't do this or can't afford this or whatever. So if you got to Uber or deliver pizza or work for Amazon, I don't really care what you do. It doesn't bother me. I wouldn't look down on anybody, but I know there are a lot of people that will look down on you, but who cares? Fuck them. Like,
I think that's, you know, and I think it's really important that we put that out there in the world that, like, you know what, it is. It's okay. Go get another job, man. Like, you know what? If you could still pursue your, you know, your dream of DJing, you know, nightlife, you know, and you got to do the side hustle thing. You got to do the side hustle thing. I mean, it is what it is. This is the first time since I'm 14 years old that I'm not working. Literally. I thought about that the other day. I'm like, this is crazy. This is the first time that I'm not
being paid. I was going to say, you're working. You're just not getting paid for it. Like, we're putting in a lot of work right now.
That's true. You know, to be honest with you, I think that the work that we have been putting in is probably more work than I've put in, you know, even when I was working two jobs. So it's kind of funny. But I think this kind of really leads us into the next thing that we really want to talk about is, you know, what does this look like when we come out of the quarantine and we're back to work? Like, what does this look like? Do these places want to pay? How do we position ourselves to get paid the right way? You know, and you know, what are some of your thoughts on how we need to come out of this pricing wise?
Yeah. I mean, this is part of what gives me anxiety on a daily basis because I've been in contact with a lot of the owners throughout this whole thing. And I mean, we know what our industry is like, and we know that they are going to try to knock the price down because they're hurting in their business and they're not going to want to pay us in not all cases, but in some cases, not going to want to pay us what our regular rates were. And I've been talking about this through the entire thing because to me, it's not okay. Like, it sucks. We're in the same boat as these guys are, where we still have bills to pay and our lives are stopped too. So I get it. Some, you know, they might not be making the numbers that they were making when we come out of this because, you know, numbers might be lower and who knows what it's going to look like. But I just feel like they're going to try to pay us less money, and we need to do whatever it takes to dissuade them from doing that. And it's not going to be easy, but I think as we always say, you know, explain, show your value, explain how you coming back can help them make more money or keep more patrons there or whatever the case may be. However you can show value to them and say, this is why I'm worth what I was making. I think that's the first thing. If it's a situation where they're like, well, I'm going to go book someone else unless you take XYZ number. If you really, really need that money, I think you need to figure out other ways that they can provide you the value that you're giving up. So whether it's DJing less hours or whether it's promoting you in some way that can help you, I don't know, live streaming up from their account on a regular nightlife basis. So for the people that aren't coming out, they still get to see you and see your name.
And that's depending on their follow it. Like too, like if you have a bigger following than the venue, like the, is that really bringing your brand worth? No, it's not. So you really have to be, you know, systematic about how you, what your approach is when you're talking to owners and managers. I think playing the a big word that we've been using throughout this whole thing is empathy and having empathy for being like empathetic to, you know, everybody's situation. It's scary because you're seeing a complete lack of empathy across the board here. So, you know, I wouldn't bank on that, but you know, to go to the ownership and say, hey, like you said, we're in the same boat and, you know, I also haven't made money in 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, you know, so we can, let's kind of, you know, team up and come out of this together, you know, on the other side of it.
What blows my mind is like,
go ahead.
We're not making $1,000 a night in most cases at local DJ gigs. If you're traveling and you're booking bigger gigs, that's one thing. But in your own personal market, like the everyday Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday gigs that you're booking is going to be market rate, whatever it is. You know, I'm not going to throw a number out. But
right.
For an owner to be like, hey, I need to cut $100 from your rate. Like to me, that's bullshit because we have a relationship with all these people and we've, on the big days where they've made a lot of money, we've helped them do that. And it's like, to me, it's cutting money in places they shouldn't be cutting money. Pay your DJs, pay your workers what they should be getting paid or what they were getting paid, and build your debt, your party back up, and you're gonna make money. I mean,
you said
people are gonna want to come out.
You said $100, and that's a lot. Like these owners are trying to cut usually by $50, which is an insane. I don't understand what $50 is doing for these places at the end of the day, because we know in our residencies, I think we know what money comes across the bar, right? Because I want to know what that I want to know what that number is, because I want to, one thing that I'm always trying to do as a DJ is I want to have the highest ring that the place has ever had. You know, I've done that. I've gone to places that I've been at as a resident for, you know, six months to a year. And once I get to know the management, I'm like, I want to know what the ring is at the end of the night. And then I want to beat that next week. And I want to beat it the next week. Like the our closing night at one of my venues, we did a $38,000 ring and they closed the place down that night. Like I was mind blown about why, you know, and then they're trying to, you know, dick around with you for $50 here and there, $100 here and there.
Yeah.
You're doing 38 grand at the bar. Like, you know, so it's important to know what your residents, you know, what the bars are making at your residencies. And then, you know, trying to match that and being like, listen, and then you can present to the owner, this is what I'm doing for your place on a weekly basis. This way they can't dick around with you for $50. It's ridiculous.
I'm like, I'm going to have some old cranky man in the room moments coming out of this. Because for me personally, if you want me to come DJ in your place, you're paying me my rate. And if that means I'm not DJing, that means I'm not DJing because I refuse. I'm not doing it. I don't care. I think I've earned the right to not have to lower my rate. You know the value that I bring. All these places that I work at, that I'm going to be working at coming out of this, they know what I bring to the table. So I shouldn't have to lower my rate. You're not hurting that bad that you can't pay me the $100 a night or $50 a night that you're trying to cut for me. I don't want to hear it. I'm not going to hear it. I refuse.
Wow. You know,
I refuse.
I got to play devil's advocate here for a little bit. Like, so if you have an established relationship, a good relationship with certain owners or managers, you know, does that sway your flexibility?
Yeah. I mean, I'm going to say to them, like, tough. Why though? I'm going to be completely straightforward with them and say, why do you need to cut me $50? Why? I'll bring people to spend the $50 in that night. Like, I'll guarantee you that you make the extra $50 that you're going to pay me. Like, I don't know what to tell them.
Are we going to get the, I'm at X amount of capacity, I'm going to pay you X amount of dollars?
That is going to be said to DJs across the world. Right. Like, guaranteed.
Yeah. I heard, you know what I heard? Oh my gosh, who was it? It was Conflict. Conflict was talking about this with on Tweak Music with Kova over the on Friday. I think it was last Friday.
Yeah,
big shout out to Kova. That was an awesome show. I don't know if you could backlog any of that stuff. If you can go watch it, really.
I watched a bunch of it. I had to hop on a couple calls, but I watched some of it. Definitely,
I think he redid it Saturday morning, and that's when I caught it. The Conflict really brought up a lot of good points, and that's what he said. And he actually went a surprising route. I felt like he was almost, you know, almost saying, "Yeah, I can work for, you know, if you're at 50%, I could work for, you know, 50% of my rate," which I was shocked about, and how he was so open-minded to taking the pay cut. I mean, I understand where the owners are coming from, but on our side, it's the same. We're all, like I said before, in the same boat.
Right. Like, don't book a DJ if you can't pay what the market rate is then. Then open up and have an iPod playing. If you think that a DJ is not worth their rate, then play your iPod or play your house system and see what you ring that night on a Friday or Saturday. Like, I don't want to hear it. This gets me super frustrated.
It's funny how many owners don't they don't respect the DJ like they should, right? And then the minute that you pull out of there, you know, they're scrambling to find some kind of entertainment, and like the iPod's not going to serve them well.
I get it. Listen, we're in certain cases, like, people are going to have to take less money than they want to take. But I think if you do decide to go that route, I'm not going to knock anybody. We all are in a bad place. We need to make money. You got to do what you got to do. If you're going to go take less money, I would say I will do this for X amount of weeks. So I will DJ for 75% my rate for 3 weeks, and then we have to talk about bringing my rate up, or we have to bring my rate up. I think that kind of a deal needs to be made, and I think this presents an opportunity for us especially, but for anyone that has venues that you're booking other DJs, if you don't have a contract, I think now's a time to push having a contract.
You know, we've been nervous, not us, but we as the collective DJ community have been nervous about bringing contracts into nightlife because you're afraid of it getting rejected, right? So this definitely presents the number one opportunity for everybody to come in with a contract ready that says, and you know, I'm getting paid X amount of dollars, and we all have good reason for, you know, coming forth with contracts. Especially when they are going to say it's really hard. It's really hard once you go down to come back up. I don't care what the party looks like. So you need to come with a contract.
Yeah, we know that.
Yeah, we know that firsthand. So, you know, it's important to come with a contract and make sure that, you know, the people that the important people sign it. Don't get some Joe Schmo manager who is only there twice a week, you know, making the calls, who might be like a friend of yours.
We work hard to get our money up. It takes a long time to go from point A to point B. So once you get to point B, it's really hard to relinquish that and think that you're going to be able to get back up to that point. No matter what they say, they're going to talk the talk because they just want to pay you less money. And no matter what, they're like, oh yeah, when the party gets good, we'll pay you more. Yeah, I don't want to hear it.
That's the best quote ever. When the party gets good.
So yeah, so then pay me percentage of the bar. Like, let's do it that way.
I'm always behind getting a percentage of the bar.
I think bringing that up is going to be a way to help negotiate your rate to either to stay the same coming out of this. Because the minute that owners start hearing percent of the bar, generally they run and hide. Yep. So if you can get a percent of the bar and you hit up all your friends to come hang out and all your DJ friends to come hang out and spend a little money and the bar does great, you're going to kill it.
Yeah. Yeah. If you could do, hey, I'll DJ for $75 and, you know, 5%.
Listen, all day. You could pay me zero and I'll take a percent of some of the places that we work at.
Wow. Well, yeah. I mean, it depends. It depends on your place. It's knowing your place too. And you know what they're charging and
yeah. And I think the places that are going to do that are going to be the smaller places, the more bar type places that would even consider that, unless you have a giant promotion company. But you know, most people don't have that connection. So
but it's a really scary prospect. I've pitched this question to you and numerous people, like, you know, are DJs going to get put on immediately? I mean, we're seeing some bars reach out already, but you know, do the bars, no, I'm talking about bars, not nightclubs. Do the bars that regularly had DJs, do they bring them back like immediately? Or are they trying to say, because like we said, they're trying to cut $50 here and there. They're like, okay, I could save $300 to $400. Let's just say that's whatever the number is. Are they bringing them back immediately? Or are they thinking, oh my God, I could save this money and make it up at the bar?
I think once the bars are opened and the towns or states are saying, hey, patrons are allowed to come back and there is nightlife can be had in some form or fashion, I would assume people are going to, if you had a DJ prior, you probably are going to have a DJ as soon as that day starts. No? Am I blinded by being a DJ and thinking that?
I'm looking at it from the perspective of conversations that I've had with owners and managers in the past that were already hesitant on giving the DJ a deserved rate, and they're penny pinching, and that penny pinching is only going to be realized even more after this, being that they haven't made money. So their mindset is they look at it from not a night to night. They look at it from a month, like what it costs a month, right? So that number is always a scary number, or projecting it out over 6 months or even a year. That's the way I think owners look at things, where we look at them as, okay, this is what I get paid a night. You want to knock off $50 a night? Well, they're looking at $50 times however many nights they're booking DJs in a year. Like, that's how they're projecting their numbers. So it becomes scary to them. So they're like, okay, well, if I can hold off for 2 months, I can save $20,000 and it puts me in a better financial position come the end of the year. You know, so that's the mindset that we're fighting. And that's what scares me the most.
I think the places that we work at, you and I, where people are coming out for nightlife, those places are going to be open. Now, the nightclubs, to me, that's a whole other conversation, because if you're a nightclub, if your capacity that you're allowed to have enter the door doesn't get you to even, what's the point of even opening? And why filter or water down your brand? I don't know. You know, the clubs that we work with, I've also been in contact with, and I've had some conversations around this idea. And I think it really matters what the capacity number or percentage is going to be.
It makes me think about when towns, which we talked about last week, when towns on like St. Paddy's Day and the bigger days, that they actually had fire marshals at the door and they were doing capacity and what that looked like. So now I'm thinking about half of that. Now, when you don't have fire marshals at the door on those bigger days, you're probably what, X5 on the amount of people that are in there?
What do you mean? Five times?
Five times. Like five.
I don't know about that many.
Sometimes some of these rooms, you see the capacity and you're shocked. It's like 100 people. It's like, this is not a 100 people room. This is a 400.
Maybe two times capacity, or like 1.5 times.
Man, I don't know. I've seen some numbers that look ridiculous. like, oh, wow, like this is 120 capacity and there's been an easy 400 people in here, you know? I don't know. I've been in some crazy rooms like that.
I've never been in a room like that.
And then fire marshal came in and it was like, okay, we're going to keep it at capacity. And you had 120 people there. And it was like, holy shit, this looks dead. Like there's nobody in here. Now I'm thinking about, oh, well, now put that in half. And now what is that going to look like? And now as a business owner, can I realistically justify having entertainment for that many people? That's, like I said before, that's what scares the shit out of me.
Yeah. Because and I think
knowing what that looks like is.
That's the hardest thing about all this is there is no plan. There's no timeline. There's no, once we do open, this is how we're going to roll out the bars and restaurants and nightclubs. So that's super scary because we're waiting for information. Bar owners and club owners are waiting for information and we're going to be the last ones to come back.
It depends what state you're in, but it's always the last phase. I think you guys have three phases. I think we have four phases here in Florida. So it's different from state to state, but in every state, the last phase is nightlife. Now some places are going to, which gives me a little bit of hope to have some kind of entertainment to draw people in. Now I was in a town, a couple towns over last week, and it was on a Saturday
in Florida,
in Winter Garden, cool little downtown area. And I was having, you know, they allowed here, I think they're doing it in Jersey as well. They're allowing restaurants to go out into like the parking spaces that are in front of the place. So they're setting up tables out there. That place from 6 to 9 o'clock had live entertainment already. So like I was like, oh my God, there's actual hope here that, and they're not allowed to have people inside yet. So it was only outside. So they were having probably like an acoustic guitarist or something like that outside. And I think a place in Hoboken did that as well last week, right?
Yeah, that place in Hoboken also asked me to provide DJs for free to play for an hour. And like, I understand where they're coming from, but it's hard to do that. You have to offer something. Like, yeah, of course, we want to help. Like, especially if we're associated in some way with the venue, right? Of course, we want to help venues that we work with. But at the same time, it's just hard. It's hard to ask people to come do stuff for free. It's okay to ask, but you can't expect it, right?
Right. You're right. Like you shouldn't be penalized for it after the fact.
Right. Listen, if I had two working arms that I could go DJ, if a venue that we work with asked me to come play for an hour and they'll give me some food and they'll put me up, post me, like we could go live on IG, it gives me some value. Sure, I'll help you out. I'll do it once. I'll do it.
I'm looking at this in a weird. No, you shouldn't expect it. Like I said, there shouldn't you shouldn't be looked down upon for not doing it.
Yeah.
Right. Now, younger DJs are going to look at that as opportunity. You have to understand that, and I think you do. You're smart enough to understand that. But we are older in the game and more established, so you know, does that give us more of a we have a different perspective for sure. If I'm a hungry DJ and I'm young, I'm in there.
Right? Yeah. Yeah, probably.
I mean, yeah. So I think us as more experienced DJs, we also, and more established DJs, we need to look at it from both perspectives because somebody could come into some of those venues and scoop them up because of that. I look back to, and it's probably not a fair comparison, but I look back to Sandy and one of our nightclubs that we worked in literally went underwater and I was there scrubbing bottles at West 5.
Yeah, I was too, actually.
We were all there scrubbing, cleaning bottle, like cleaning the floor, cleaning bottles, making sure, you know, dragging refrigerators out of the basement. And I think that helped us after the fact.
Yeah, but we were also like a big family there. So like, it depends, you know, like we were hanging out there after hours and as a group, the bartenders, DJs and staff would hang out outside of work also.
Yeah.
So I think it depends on the situation. I think it depends how invested you are in the party anyway, period.
Well, that and how close you are, I think, with owners and like
right,
you said.
And how they've treated you also, yeah. You know? It's how good the relationship is and how much of that venue or that party that you feel a part of, right?
Oh, like I could tell you right now, if Sona 13 was still open and I was their resident, right? And we were still there. And this all had gone down, I would have gone in and tried to draw people in by going to DJ for nothing, you know? But that's because they provided me with so much value. They've given right. me personally so much value. Whether it's, I have lifetime friends that I've made that were just regulars from there, you know? And the owner is a lifetime friend of mine now. So I knew, you know, I knew that. So, and I knew how much value they brought to just my life in general, not only my DJ brand. So, you know, you're right. It is circumstantial. It depends on, you know, where you're, what place you're talking about, but like a place that you don't really have a relationship with that has the balls to come to you and say, hey, come in here and DJ for mozzarella sticks. Like the fuck out of here. Like, you know, it's different. Yeah. You have to understand. I think as the owner and as the manager, you have to understand what relationship you have with the DJ that you're asking to do, you know, who you're asking to DJ for free.
Right. Because they're asking us to come so they can make money, right? Or more money. So how come we don't get a piece of that? Like right. we're making you guys more. You're asking me to take time out of my day, come to your venue, DJ, and help you make money, but you're going to not pay me? Yeah. I don't know. Like,
I go back and forth. There's a million ways to chop this up.
Of course.
You know, it's all perspective. No, you know,
I think you and I, there's a value in creating and building relationships. And if you need to go DJ for 1 hour to build, to help cultivate a relationship, it's worth it. If it's going to help you down the line, right?
Yeah. Yeah. You know, we
at the end of the day. We can talk trash, or you know, we can speak to both sides of it, because there's pros and cons each way. I mean,
I think there needs to be, if you think that the management and the ownership of the place is asking you to come play for nothing, if you think that there is, you know, long-term respect and something really good is going to come out of it, it's absolutely worth it. Right? I think that's really what it comes down to. Because you have to do what's right for you, and you have to look out for yourself. Like,
yeah, and the venues are looking out for themselves too. They're going to say, hey, we've booked you with so much. You made a lot of money here. Come help us out, kind of thing. And I get that too.
That's the other thing that you have to understand.
Yeah.
Like I said, referring to Sona before, like I know how much money they put in my pocket, and I know what kind of position they put me in. So, you know.
It's situational, 100%.
Yeah, that's it.
All right. So the last thing that we wanted to talk about, last Friday, we hosted a Zoom party and we asked everyone who came onto the party to donate at least $1. So all the proceeds went to Staten Island University Hospital. And how much money would we raise? Like how much?
It was around $700, which was excellent. We didn't have 700 people on. But you know, people dug into their pockets and they contributed, and it was a really good time. We got to showcase a lot of our talent, which was nice. And then we all got to hang out like we would on a normal weekend. So,
yeah, it was refreshing. It was cool to be able to hang out with all the guys and girls, and a lot of the people that support the Get Down DJs and our brand. So that was super cool. It was definitely a success. I mean, we had a steady number of people on the Zoom party throughout the whole thing. So much appreciated. It was super cool. We're going to do another one and, you know, the money will go to another hospital. But
so funny story about the Zoom party real quick that I didn't even tell you yet. I forgot to tell you. So I'm golfing with this guy that I met in my community a couple weeks ago yesterday. And he's like, who was that one guy that came on? Everybody was commenting and going crazy. And I'm like, trying to figure out. We're like halfway down the ninth hole yesterday. And I'm like, who are you talking about? And he's like, I don't know. I think his name was with a D. You know, he was kind of funky. He was like a funny guy. He had like a mustache. I'm like, oh my God, Dario. He's like, Yeah. He's like, what the hell was going on? Why was everybody going crazy? The fun part about this party was that, like, we got to hear sides of some of our DJs that we haven't heard, and Dario dropping hip hop bangers was surprising to me. And like,
I think it was surprising to everybody.
And that's why everybody was going crazy. The fact that an outsider that knows nobody in the whole Zoom could see that there was a very real reaction to Dario dropping crazy hip hop classics.
Yeah, big shout to DJ Dario Valley. He did his thing. He surprised a lot of people. I was getting texts on the side like, damn, I didn't know Dario had this in him. But I think he wanted to prove a point and show everybody, because he's really known to be, you know, more of a house head. He loves house music. That's what he produces. So I think he wanted to make a little bit of a statement. I think he did a good job with that.
He did a great job. And I think that's the fun in these things, in these Zoom parties, in these live streams, in these DJ battles, is that, you know, not only did we get to raise money for a really, really good cause, but we also got to hear different sides of DJs that even, you know, that we know like the back of our hands. Apparently we don't. So yeah, no, that was definitely a lot of fun. I had a good time with that.
Yeah. I always like the Zoom party style. For DJs going live, I just feel like it's more personal. It's more fun. It can be more interactive. You know, especially when there's an MC and we can take shots and shout people out, and it's just fun. I enjoy it. And Dramos was someone who, you know, started doing this, and he's doing one tonight that I'm going to hop on and hang out on for a little while. But, you know, one way to spend some time with your DJ friends while on quarantine.
Yeah, and I mean, I hope that it doesn't go away, because it is just a good way to, you know, be in your house, have a good time, not spend a lot of money. You know, if you're looking to do that, or, you know, if you're not booked, you could still, like, you know, reach out to friends and kind of get together and play some music and have a good time. But definitely big shout to Dramos, because he was definitely an inspiration.
Shout to those guys. Shout to our guys who kind of helped put that together. Angela the Kid and DJ UFOso and everybody that DJed with us. But yeah, I think this is a good point to wrap it up. I don't know, Gary, you got anything else for the people out there?
No, just appreciate you guys tuning in, you know, every week and hearing us bullshit and, you know, hearing these little banters that we have back and forth that we were having anyway. But I'm just glad that we're able to bring it to everybody. And you know, we've had some really good feedback on it. And I'm really happy that people are tuning in and listening. Yeah, and hopefully it's bringing value to some of you.
Yeah, I mean, it's good to talk through some of this stuff, you know, so other people can hear where we're at on it and how we're thinking and how we plan on approaching certain things, because I think that can help people. So I hope you guys take something from what Gary and I talk about. Thank you guys for tuning into The Get Down, and we'll talk to you guys soon.
Catch you next week. Later, guys.